Gonna hold that. Hi everyone, and welcome to a Zell Visiting Writers series reading Q&A with Wendy S. Walters. My name is Michaela Coates, and I'm your host for this evening. In case you don't yet know about our program and what we do, the Zell Writers Program brings 12 acclaimed authors to University of Michigan each year with our students in their public readings, craft talks, and Q&As, and the series is generously funded by Zell and Jane Rick. So I'm going to start by giving just a few admin announcements before we move towards the reading. The first is to note that this event is recorded and will be posted on the Zell Visiting Writer Series YouTube channel where anyone can watch later on. If you're joining us on Zoom, closed captioning is enabled, and you can turn that on or off by pressing the CC icon on the bottom of your Zoom screen. We will also post a copy of Wendy's reading in the Zoom chat shortly. And for the order of tonight's event, in just a minute, I'm going to student tomorrow, Ashlat, will introduce Wendy. After that, we will be meeting for about 25 minutes. And at 6 p.m., another student, Karen, will have a conversation with Wendy. Karen's having a couple of others tonight, so we might also switch to audience questions a little bit early, so make sure you have some ready. So we'll have probably about 10 minutes to open up the audience questions. If you're here in person, you can line up at the mics on either side of the stage to ask your questions. And if you're on Zoom, then you can submit your questions through the Q&A function and we'll read them aloud on your behalf. So that's all. And we're going to go to tomorrow for an introduction. My first encounter with Wendy S. Walters' writing was her essay, Chicago Radio, The Multiply Divide, for a craft course last fall on the art of the essay. Only a few weeks into graduate school, it was safe to say I had never read anything like it before. The complexity and texture of the writing, UFO sightings alongside nutritional statistics, alongside dialogue between radio DJs and callers, captured the magnitude of and possibilities when producing prose, navigating narrative, and encountering empathy through the essay. Walters, in her essay Cleveland, writes, "To hear an account of the personal is a curious phenomenon because for me, the tale must reflect on my own experience to feel relevant. The story must engage my empathy by creating a space for me to witness and recognize. An account of the personal illustrates an evolving consciousness, one that might be instructive, even though it is neither fixed nor certain. The personal must be true, though that does not mean historically accurate. It is precisely this capacity for creating space to, quote, witness and recognize on the page that makes Walters' writing so impactful. More than a year after reading Chicago Radio for the first time, I have now shared this and other essays from Multiply and Divide with my introduction to creative writing course. When discussing one particular essay in the classroom last week, teasing through the real and the surreal together, I watched as my students grappled with finding their own meanings within the writing. Students opened themselves up to their peers, sharing ways in which perception has hurt them, how identity isn't always visible, and the significance of how we engage with the other. Again, I witnessed the immense value of encountering a work that pushes readers into a sometimes uncomfortable but ultimately fruitful place. In addition to her most recent book of prose, Multiply/Divide, on the American Real and Surreal, named a best book of the year by Buzzfeed, Literary Hub, Huffington Post, and others, Wendy S. Walters is also the author of two books of poetry, Troy, Michigan, and Longer I Wait, More You Love Me. More of Walters' published work can be read in Bond, the Iowa Review, Lapham's Quarterly, Full Bleed, and Harper's, among many others. Walter is a recipient of fellowships from the New York Foundation for the Arts, the Ford Foundation, and the Smithsonian Institute. Currently, Walter serves as director of the Nonfiction Concentration and associate professor of nonfiction in the writing program at Columbia University. Walters was born in Michigan and lives in New York City with her husband and son. As writers, educators, students, artists, we can certainly learn from Walters as she writes, paying attention often requires some sort of empathy for the subject, or at the very least for the speaker. but empathy these days is hard to come by. Maybe this is because everyone is having such a hard time understood themselves, or because empathy requires us to dig way down into the murk. May we all take note from Walters and push ourselves, embark on the excavation within to the place, quote, deeper than our feelings go, to a place where the boundaries between our experience and everyone else's no longer exist. Please join me in giving Wendy S. Walters a warm welcome. We are so grateful to have her with us in Ann Arbor tonight. Thank you so much to all of you for making time to come out, thanks to Ashley, to Zell, thanks to for suggesting so I have some plans and the essay. Presentation today. First sentence of the book called Permission, which is a book that is a series of sonnets that about my experiences growing up, but I guess one of the things of what I work on is kind of the persistence and persistence of violence. And so this book is explaining the architecture of the suburbs and the design of the suburbs, a series of challenges that are happening in Akron. So I'll read a few poems from this, and I think I will read a few poems. I apologize, I have a staple that is impeding my progress. It must be both. And I want to say that I am a stutter, so if I stutter, don't worry, it will be there. So, sentence. The sky, it's outside gray city. Set short expectation of distance. So the wrangles of type. It's the real question. To start, take a short run through the woods, feeling the desire for safety as you unclothe them. You're always talking about taking the woods. Each of us fortress will put together. Says the application, the lesson. Virgins. Her pen dangerously sharp to her eyes. She has the sky. She crossed the sky. She crossed the sky. It's like water for her.
A sound was lost between two leaning walls. Outside, a city of bronze, shiny dim, vanished into legend. You know that one, Helen and her face, the men in their war. the saga of empire, the sea. Our myths disappear too. Tales of hanging drywall, planting gardens, watching soccer practice at dusk. Instead of heroes, we became bumps and potholes on the surface, slowing the road. We crave expansion, new lots cleared by diggers and backhoes. Anywhere else gets an epic, why not us? Our lives ringing true as bells without a clapper. Go open the great gates of the city. Ilion. City on a hill, what ambitions you cast centuries forward with your name. Points manifest west, each a little less auspicious than the last one called Troia. Factory-fueled towns, fated to fall hard from industry, towns that stole trees to claim wealth and esteem as aspiration, then turned soil to grit, will not die either. You remain too far away from triumph to claim a legacy, but still this trick, naming a new city for a defeated one, is to commit to optimism. Fools navigate the end of an era, seeking direction in a starless sky. Out of Troy, New York. Who knows which city was the first Detroit? All states claim a version of the fall. Upstate New York in Rensselaer County, where Uncle Sam the Butcher is buried. Is ancient America enough to start? Textile kings in Collar City, grand launderers invented an industry. Some men were called to dirt instead, to dig and seed to grow. Covered wagons roll Erie Canal. Covered wagons roll Ohio. Michigan shimmers in rivers and lakes like nowhere at all. A Troy named again invites myths of walled cities and idols of speed into the woods to undo us. So this book is in sections. There's the whole thing is sonnet, so I don't know why. I like that form as a technology. There's also like little bricks for me. It felt like I was working with little bricks and a larger story. So this is another section. This piece is called Memoir. This is not a map. References betray obvious injuries for fact. At the start, she envisioned an eye who overcame my sensitivity to confession and broke skin. No place reveals a single point, time changes people. She became one more version of herself. I witnessed the absence of record and wrote it down in pencil. Obtuse angles lengthen origin myths. She called me out because I did not want to vanish. Gone where I started from, she invented this book of lists. She put story fragments in order by color. She led the woods and tangled history. Winter. Under overcast skies, children practice blame and violence better than gloominess. It covers their feet like bedclothes. Whiteness surrounds them like music, down into the ear. Through a dark window, the street blurs, a moon's gravity ruined. Porch lights left on all night will not reveal why some kids lack empathy, or how long it will take them to shed their anchor, feel longing that leads them to gentler people. Woods. Leaves on tall boughs make the sound of applause in the distance. When rain bends trees, here comes longing. A girl studies the plot of these woods for proof of her feeling. A tangled, shadowy boss cage, the creek beds stalled mud. The girl hides from those who don't seek her out. And the impulse to build in all directions starts with seizing the birds or seeds aloft, then rooting in lawns or unkempt gardens. Time to sabotage intruding saplings if what they foment is thicket or dusk. From the damp mulch, a sky appears cracked by new branches pulled too far from the root. More untold aspirations falling down. Hackberry, hawthorn, hickory, black gum, trembling aspen, beech, maple, musselwood, crabapple, dogwood, pawpaw, oak, 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 nimbus. A sky scratched happily a child's drawing. The grass softens towards her. God is near, but not more free than she is. This brown hand on your face is a girl who expects clouds. Then she is me, looking dull as paper. Now she rides her red bike one block over to the reservoir. A world this small fades. Even a bevy of hornets dissolve, ellipses of emotion in pale light. Down the street, a house on fire flickers out. Now she walks to kiss a boy who smells of smoke and hay. She will not get it yet. Why she needs to give into impulse, discard reason for the cool taste clay. Here. Look at them looking like they don't know how they look. Why don't they just stay where they stay or drag sideways across our fields, come at us zigzag over the rows we cut? We made a place they know they should not stay for a reason. They were nothing back when we started from nothing, or we would not have worked so hard to be right. They never do what they need to do to be right. Who knows? Someone might kill one. We tell them this if they don't run. Come on, try us, we say. A city grows over the rows we cut, then they come at us. We stay for reasons. They don't understand right the way we do. Oakland County, Michigan, 1976. Back then, a fear of strangers did not feel small-minded. Too many outsiders lived in neighborhoods. Why not predict trouble from missing? A weakness in the bloodline, or faith forgotten, turned a winter sky slick. Around the country, impossible news provoked whispers. Mark Stebbins, age 12, vanished February 15th. 4 days later, his body placed in a snowbank as if sleeping. A slow, verdant season of disbelief followed. Oblivion reinstated the doldrums. But when Jill Robinson, also 12, vanished December 22nd, police took our fingerprints at school. The Oakland County Child Killer, 1977. Why do we have details beyond facts and fate when the lack of love remains unsolved? Christine Michalik bought a magazine from the convenience store on January 2nd. On March 16th, Timothy King's sister loaned 30 cents for drugstore candy. Days after disappearing, their bodies were left in the snow along a major road like the children abducted last year. The FBI launched its biggest manhunt to date, but no indictments ever came. Riding in cars, we studied the shoulders of roads for small bodies like ours. Proof violence roots like ragweed grows everywhere. Stolen. Any direction one looks at the sky, someone falls away from the universe. The air of colder seasons pushed through walls and doors, promised to expose bone. This is not the kind of loss one should romance, but I did not understand what made them so wanted. Envy made me learn sorrow very early on, or pain through acrobatic feats of desire. I confused leaving with abduction, family with calamity. I could not recall a time before kids went missing from sidewalks, so say I had no perspective. I practiced vanishing to find I had always been somewhere else. I regained those things did not apply to the place that made me sharp. It flickered out and vanished in storms. The project of romancing winter relies on salt's advantage over ice. Snow shields simple mysteries from the sun. Pretend to know me, and you will see why we do wrestle for heat. If I am foreshadowing or catastrophe, you are delusion or spell casing. Neither one of us explains conflict action alone. Parallel roads diverge, confirm sadness. From the shoulder, I count instances of being passed by. Invisible means I am here, burning. Cold. I ran anywhere without asking first. At the end of a road, I met a door built to close when I called. Years of doors, then the sky turned low and gray on me too. Before I could tell God why I shouldn't be so lonely, a letter explained my lack of distinction in cursive. You are not what I thought of, but I think of you, it made plain. I unraveled the words and hand drew this map to rescue me from statelessness. The next time I started the story over, the next time I let you believe you heard me say this before, something like this, but bitter. Thank you. Hey, on to part A. Okay, so some of you may not know that I was an undergraduate student here. I guess nobody knew that, but I did. And I loved it here, and I went to many other institutions afterwards, and I know some people it's very small, but for me it was very big when I came here, and accessed all kinds of learning that I couldn't before. But even before I came here, I was a high school student. And my cousin went to U of M, and my mom let me visit him 1 weekend in college, when he was in college. So this is a piece about that weekend, and I bought I'll tell you about the geography later, all of here. But I'd like to share with you the Black Law Students Association. Has anybody been to the BLSA? Oh, okay. You won't miss it next time. A friend with whom I like to talk about books and power asked me why I seldom write about joy. He said it was important for people to witness the delight of others, that to commit to share it would serve the greater good. I confessed to him that I thought to write about pleasure seemed hubristic, a way to court nemesis. I told him that I worry what gives me joy will seem incoherent to others who do not see beauty where I see it, who do not hear music where I hear it, and who do not know how to embrace affection where, for me, it naturally springs forward. My happiness is personal, thus untranslatable. To write about it requires me to attempt to decipher it, which is neither possible nor desirable. And yet I knew he was right. In my memories of coming of age in Michigan, I am aware and most grateful for the cold weather and the stamina I earned from enduring it. Imagine a bitter cold and gray early November day in 1987, where after the new student orientation at the University of Michigan, I walked with my friend Christy through the tree-lined quad to visit my cousin Brian at his dormitory room. My cousin Brian from Detroit studied psychology. His friend, also named Brian, studied engineering. And both of them seemed confident that they could fit Christy and me into this party, even though we were underage. There's no high hill to stand upon in order to reveal the vista here. My motivations were unsophisticated. I wanted to be at a party with law students because I did not know what lawyers were like. I had only met one attorney in my life, my uncle, but he never discussed his work. But I did see lawyers on television all the time. As a young child, I watched reruns of The Paper Chase and Perry Mason. In my early adolescence, women in tailored suits arrived both sexy and capable in the Hill Street Blues character of Joyce Davenport, who took no guff. By the time I was a full-grown teenager, the irrepressible Grace Van Owen of LA Law lit every room with a curt exactitude and flowing silk blouses in neutral tones. Claire Huxtable had all the right answers on The Cosby Show, and she was the only Black woman lawyer I had ever seen. Maybe the 1980s misinformed my appreciation for the legal profession. It was a harsh time in which to be a vulnerable person. People were frugal with their generosity, often cruel for the sake of a laugh, courting favor with those who cared the least about others, and that attention, once won, was always temporary. We shunned those who let their pain be visible. In my parents' social circles, even cancer was considered to be a bit of the patient's own fault, as friends whispered or spelled out the name of the disease to avoid inviting it into one's own body. The world I came of age in divided into winners and losers, ranked against a set of values that dictated access to status and celebrity. Back then, I had no vision of myself I wanted to share with others, probably because I had not yet decided if I would be a winner or a loser. I lived deep in my wounds and carried with me an air of isolation and loneliness like a best friend, which made me suspect I might be a loser. But I could turn harshly critical too, in a way that I was not yet prepared to admit, and that made me wonder if I, in fact, might be a winner. This debate played out only in my mind, as I did not feel self-conscious enough to think this way about my body yet. And I liked to think I could dance, though my style left my legs solid as a tree trunk, my arms waving in the air. In that way, I imagined a kinship with British songwriter Kate Bush, who moved somehow outside of the system of valuation. It turns out I could not dance at all. But my cousin Brian and his friend Brian loved Kate Bush too. They affirmed my feelings, as did so many young Black men we knew in Detroit who appreciated her multiple voices, architectural harmonies, control of emotional tone, and limitless influences. This might seem irrelevant to the story and let you understand that unlike the Donnas, Kate Bush's music did not sell well in the US. We appreciated her obscurity. Our affection for her hinted to our own emerging creative inclinations, which we had not yet confessed to each other. We listened to songs from her 1984 album, Hounds of Love, and felt full of potential. Ann Arbor is only 40 miles from where I had been raised, far enough to allow me to imagine a life without parent expectations. All of our parents expected us to attend college, and their friends implied our best chance to make a good life for ourselves would be in the automobile industry. Cousin Brian's dad worked at Cadillac, and his mom from the UAW. Christy's father practiced as an engineer at the GM Tech Center, and my father managed human resources at the Chevrolet Gear and Axle plant. He had recently bought me two Oxford shirt dresses. These pastel painted blue garments fabricated as elongated dress shirts with a narrow leather belt cinched at the waist represented to him a sharp feminine take on menswear, as if to suggest I might find a career in one of the plant offices. My dad believed that the auto industry, though flagging, could still be redeemed by young people who committed their talents to the company, as if the choice between failure and success of a business had been the workers all along. A lot would change in the next few years, but even in retrospect, it's hard to comprehend. By 1986, General Motors had announced plans to shut 11 factories around the country, ending 15,000 jobs in southeastern Michigan. The Detroit Assembly Cadillac plant closed in 1987, and 20 miles north, the Onion Assembly ended production in 1988. Longtime GM rival Chrysler announced the final model year of its large Jefferson Avenue plant and additional layoffs in 1989, which marked a clear sign that the auto industry had hit its second recession in the 1980s. More than 300,000 residents would be in the city proper in the 1974 to 1986. And with 636 killings in 1985, Detroit won the distinction of murder capital of the US. Though it would have seemed difficult for things to get worse, bad news kept coming. These are the facts of an industry as it stalls out, though they reveal little about what imbroglio results for the workers who are let go. Where do their strong feelings go? In 1990, GM's chairman Bob Stempel announced the end of 21 more plants, which would allow for the elimination of 20,000 salary jobs by the mid-1990s. To my family's surprise, one of those positions would be my father's. I did not know that back then, by the late 1980s, large-scale upward mobility of the Black middle class had ceased. That meant kids like me would have trouble maintaining the class position of our parents. In the era, it may have been an impossible phenomenon to witness, but I do think that many young people could feel the engine of opportunity slowing down. Though never discussed in my family, already evidence suggested that some of us would not fare better than our parents' generation. But the truth is, back then, I looked for any moment to prove that I was the exception rather than the rule. I even thought my family to be rich. There was no question about whether or not I would go to college. My mother required it. This would be years before I understood that real wealth was not tied to one's meeting one's natural needs. In my Black middle class, most of the mothers had their own professional careers too. Those of us who lived in the Tony Tree-lined suburbs of Detroit always knew, even as children, that a layoff, a strike, or a work stoppage might lead to a family separation or relocation. As these jolts to community had already become common among my parents' friends. Once they sold the house, families announced plans to move to new plants in southern states, Tennessee, Texas, or Georgia, or to cities with industries in other fields, Phoenix or Las Vegas. Ironically, no one I knew moved from the suburbs back to the central city of Detroit, where the options to find a more suitable home were plentiful. Detroit's empty housing stock swelled with many homes in lighted areas, but also several magnificent colonials in tiny, well-managed communities, with neighbors two or three generations deep. Back then, the city's empty homes and storefronts garnered national attention for the spectacle of arson on the night before Halloween, what we call Devil's Night. The suburbs had their own incidents sparked by disquietude, an unsolved series of child murders, drug syndicates that operated for decades out of the far end of the cul-de-sac, random abductions or assaults on shoppers leaving the mall. Pockets of neglect characterized even the newest development, an overgrown yard here, a boarded up four-bedroom colonial there, light crept up in the neighborhood across from my nationally recognized public high school, where the talk of vacation houses and university represented the shared values of those in the community. Just before the party, Christy and I bought new outfits with the $27 in gas money we had between us after a last-minute realization that our clothes were not up to par. I chose a tight black spandex dress, which I thought paired well with my cream-colored cowboy boots. She sported a short white miniskirt, the likes of which her parents would never approve. Neither of the outfits we chose gave us the air of sophistication we hoped to pull off. And we both knew it. While we shopped, the Bryans changed into their version of Starter Fair. Cousin Brian chose one of his Grammy outfits, a colorful patchwork shirt in rayon or other synthetic fabric, which even then he suspected one should only wear to the annual televised music award show. He had bought it in the basement of the Bivouac, an Ann Arbor shop known for outdoor and athletic goods. His friend Brian sported a Cosby sweater in order to appear mature and put together, but also not to look too old, as he was already enamored by a few of the law students. We all were reaching. Here's the deal with privilege. To access more of it, one must cross a threshold. We cut across the U of M Law Quad, a series of connected buildings that emulate the English Gothic style of the late Middle Ages. Nothing like I had ever encountered. In later years, I would learn it was designed by architects Edward York and Philip Sawyer, who met in the 1890s while designing New York's original Penn Station. The main entrance to the quad features a triumphal arch and arcade, which leads to the cloister composed of Doric columns and round-headed arches, and a style reminiscent of other campuses of distinction, such as Yale University or the famous New College at Oxford. The Lawyers Club, its dormitory and dining hall in which the party was held, features a great window on its east wall. Here, strong vertical lines repeat through the design with oversized windows that once flamboyant and beyond human scale. We stepped into a blue pulsating light. We could see the room full of emotion. People touched each other on the shoulder, on the back, hand to hand, as they greeted each other or passed by. The DJ projected colorful lights into the crowd from his stand, and the strobe flashed in rhythm to the music. As I glanced around the room at the crowd, I noticed the dancers did not take up much space, but with their shared rhythm, drove the beat even to the floor. With ruffles and shoulder pads, their style exemplified the languid funk of the regulars of a local television dance show, Nat Morrison's The Scene, or its previous successor, the new dance show with Touche, on station WGPR TV 62. With its low held camera angles and quick successive jumps. In this veil of motion and ambition, the markers of financial access, education, and class mobility composed a hill on one side, and incarceration, segregation, and disenfranchisement rose high on the other. I inhaled the cool air of indifference. The party showcased the most glamorous blackness I had ever known. It swept down from the sky like a weather pattern, a high blue northern coming across the Great Lake, so cosmic it blew clear. Blackness unfurled like a freshly paved road on a night drive through the Metroplex. It rumbled through the outer atmosphere smooth as a Model 500 with no UFO interference. And after that, it dressed androgynous for church while it rocketed fuzz through the Creole galaxy. I saw it get up and get out centuries past our lifetime, this everlasting blackness that dragged every song's intro into an outro, into an intro. Even Christy and I stood around while we danced it together a little, as rhythm is rhythm got under our skin with strings of life. The jets were all over him, but it would be a decade before we got over the jets. Frank Broussard, aka Egyptian Lover, called out to the ancestral knowledge of the diaspora as he instructed, "Pyramids are oh so shiny, the women here are oh so cute. The freaks are on the dance floor now, dancing to beats that I compute." And Jay Big Bad prep lectured the room with, "We know you like us girls, so you better get sterile, because we are the home chicks that are rocking your world." What is joy if not to be unbothered by others? Look at those Huxtables in their very fine life. So good at courting comfort and ease that they could not help but be admired. These images of cloud that carried a man into the living room of my living room television of my suburban house evidence how little I understood about how influence moved behind the scenes. Like many others, I succumbed to the allure of beautiful young women, the edgy confidence of Denise, the sober affection of Sandra, the cheerful candor of Vanessa, or the unabashed confidence of the baby daughter, Rudy. Cosby's Dr. Huxtable, the gynecologist, smirked through all seven seasons while women flanked him like a private army. Together, their good humor and grace buffered the paterfamilias of unending appetites and criticism as he cut into all of the cakes.
Wendy, we have time for about a minute or two more.
That joy exists without privilege is possible. Perhaps this is the pleasure some call contentment, but it is also so personal that it wields a minimal presence. The pessimist in me thinks that more often one's elation arises at the expansion of privilege, whether perceived or manifest. To deny the seductive and intoxicating lift that a momentary rise in standing gives me is to lie, or at the very least, obscure the truth so much that the likelihood of true happiness fades. I did not speak to a single law student at the party, but I had no regrets about this. Cousin Brian convinced two of his friends to ask me to dance, but I rejected them out of nervousness. Once we left the party, we drove one town over for hamburgers. I know Cousin Brian and his friend Brian warned us to watch for police, but I don't know if we listened to the Midnight Funk Association with famed DJ Charles Johnson, aka the electrifying logo on the radio, or more Kate Bush. Picture the gray dashboard of the car and the white light behind the numbers, analog, of course, on the speedometer, some brighter idea of myself lit in my brain as we pass the spindly forest groves of native trees stretching their bare limbs toward the star-dotted firmament. If we had kept driving that night, we would have passed General Motors' second Willow Run assembly plant that stood at the border of the two cities near the site of the original bomber plant from World War II. Here, manufacturer Henry Ford turned the process of building airplanes into wide-scale manufacturing of B-24 Liberators, the airplane onto which Rosie the Riveter had directed her feminine fortitude. Willow Run would close permanently in 1994, but if we listened hard, we might have heard the conveyor belt pulls steel hundreds of miles across the factory floor, dragging the Black middle class into a fragile and temporary prosperity alongside it. But White Castle beckoned us with its white-tiled walls and cool blue awnings. We ate hamburgers and fries and tried to impress each other with stupid stories. We laughed so hard our stomachs hurt. What did we say to each other? If I could remember any joke I appreciated at that age, I'd confess it now, but I don't. I just know I felt great, some pleasure in proximity to access or power. As we sat in the overlit restaurant, settled stiffly in the cool air around the white formica tabletop, we experienced relief from all expectations of discipline that would normally shape our social interactions. But what made us roar with such delight on the night that would elicit such deep nostalgia all these years later? Only cousin Brian knew what had set us off. He said he had told us a story about the last time he was at White Castle, years earlier while finishing high school in Detroit. A woman who appeared to be high on some drug kept falling asleep as she tried to order her meal. Still standing, she would nod out after speaking just a few words, other than then sleep for several minutes before attempting her order again. Once served, the woman in the back booth took bites of her burger and dozed off between each one. She kept eating and falling asleep, holding upright the whole time. Consider the faint smell of pickles, thin mist on the window, our cohort howling with incipient egos dripping.
I can't see you again. Can everyone hear me? Was that? It was great.
Thank you for listening. When was the last time you were here? Oh, I guess.
Yeah,
so
I think that's interesting for us because I know many of us have lived in Michigan for a few years now, but if anyone knows anything like I would, I have no assumption of what Michigan was before I came here. So I hear writing about the area of history a few years before this meeting. And I'd love to hear a little bit about the process of writing Troy, Michigan book. I know you grew up there, and on top of that, I had to do a bit of research for the book as well. So I'd love to hear about what that process was like.
Yeah, thank you. So my process is usually very research intensive. So I, spent a lot of time looking at sequencing documents, looking at historical records, a lot of time at a Troy Historical Museum. At that point, I wasn't really thinking I'd be writing essays regularly. So I was trying to write a book that was comprised of small units that I could manage, but that could also be about something larger. So that kind of was the tension for me. And I had written a book, a chapbook of poems many years ago about California, but it's a book that we can't get anywhere anymore, or verse of Los Angeles. But that was also in sonnets. That was in Keatsian sonnets, and Keats. These were open sonnets, though. Ten syllables.
Yeah. Earlier today in our talk, we were talking a bit about genre and kind of what you pay attention to in genres. Is there anything you approach differently when you go about poetry versus nonfiction in those research processes or writing?
I mean, it's interesting because poets right now are so good that I often compare. It's really good. The book is really interesting. So I know that I have a different process. I think I am drawn to complex, winding storytelling in poems or in essays. And essays accommodate that maybe a little easier, the kinds of stories that I want to tell. But, reading poems, I'm definitely inspired by what I read. I was recently starting a project that probably won't go anywhere, but starting a project and trying to think, oh, maybe I could turn this into a book of poems, but it already feels like there's too much in there. What I have grown accustomed to is hiding less. I'm less willing to hide parts of the story that I want to tell, which is something that I thought that I had to do when I was writing poetry primarily. But I don't think that's true for everybody because poetry right now seems to be good. Mm-hmm. So, what do I know?
I imagine when we get audience questions, we might have some about these projects, but that's a little about what you've done outside of these two. And I found one of your projects, Fictions of Emancipation, Carlo Recast, which was a collaboration.
Well, it was a co-curation, yeah.
Co-curation. And you described it as a sustained collaboration.
Yes, our process of curating was sustained. Yes, well, he's Nelson. We got the net, and I worked on a show that just recently closed in March, centered around a bust of a Black woman from 19th century France by Jean-Baptiste Carpeaux. It's an image of a woman's chest is bare, and there's a rope taken back her. And it's a work that has been produced in copies, multiples. Carpeaux produced it in copies, sold it widely, made huge profits from it. And it's in many of the museums around the world as an example of kind of a representation of Black women from the 19th century. What's misunderstood about that sculpture is a lot of people think it's a representation of a woman who's been enslaved, but actually it was a free woman who posed for that picture. And slavery had been abolished in France 20 years previously. So what we were trying to do is bring that work and many other works in conversation to ask what was the motive of representation in continuing to bind images of Black people after emancipation.
Mm-hmm. And writing is so often thought of as a solitary kind of endeavor that we take on. How did you even come to enter kind of a collaborative space? Is that something that's been in your practice? Or something you have been recently?
Yeah, when I was a student here, I was very involved in music school. And I was not a musician, but most of my friends were musicians. It was also the era of women's art. this is a very active performer and very poor at performing, not talented. Eager and invested. I have always loved doing collaborative work events. My collaborators here, the composer Derek Romero, who I collaborated with for over 20 years. I've always enjoyed that work. I don't know if the writing work, I think, is always being separate from that. And collaborative work, I think, is twice as hard as writing. But it can be very rewarding if you find the right partners.
Thank you. I have a lot more questions, but I want to leave time for audience questions if you haven't.
We're okay to go over a little bit. If you need to, you can take another 10 minutes if you need, since we started late.
I have one kind of off-beat question I want to get in just because I'm very curious. And one of the most common things about your writing these two projects was how you mentioned winter and snow. And I know it's probably significant that we're based in Michigan and based coming up. But it almost seemed to move from emotion almost into a character. The snow takes on some type of agency in certain scenes. And so I wanted to ask if you were to think of snow or winter as a character in your work, what is that character? And does it change across your projects and what have you come across this?
Oh, what a great question. I've never thought about it that way, but I think winter, what race it brings, and we're increasingly aware of how rare winter is, how precious it is. I can say that I have always been a fan of the season. It's like all possible energies come and are at play and are visible. So it's atmospheric, it's precipitation, there's wind at play. It's an incredible wind. It's wonderful. And it can be challenging if you're trying to get to work or you're trying to get to school. But if you see to the fact that you can't get anywhere, and you just give into it and let the beauty of the snow wash over you, it's amazing. But it's also, it's like the sea. It's not it claims its own, right? And so I meet it with great reverence, but I also respect it, respect that you know, survival is not inevitable.
Thank you. And one more question before we turn it over. I know what your bio says you're completely without pain, which is just ambiguous enough to be wildly intriguing.
Yeah.
Can we learn more about that project as well as anything else we have on the list?
Working on it. Everybody keeps asking, and it's still not done, and it seems like it should be done long ago, and it's not. But yeah, it's, you know, it's my investment in aesthetics, but also trying to think about the politics of design. So it's not done. And I'll be able to keep up, but it's not. So I will be happy to talk about it as soon as possible. Thank you for asking.
Okay, at this time, I'll open the space if anyone else has questions. We can come to the mic. And I think we're on Zoom as well. If you want to type any in the chat, we can also go to the screen.
Really enjoyed your talk. Thank you so much for coming here. I had a question specifically about empathy. You talk a lot about it a lot. What are some ways I think that, or do you think that that we can do more in promoting empathy as humans, I guess? It feels really hard to connect to people these days. So I just want to hear some of your thoughts.
Thank you for that question. I don't know if I have a good answer. You know, I do feel, I've been feeling lately a little bit of nostalgia for the time that I was fortunate to have before the web took over everything. I was here, you know, with the internet, but it wasn't the primary means of social exchange. I do feel like creative production that is hidden away from the internet is really important. And I do find that there's certainly a group of people my age who are doing really cool things and do not post them. And we're really deliberate about not naming or sharing what's happening. Because one of the things that I think happened with web culture is that the subcultures all died out, or the subcultures all became accessed by watching as opposed to accessed by participation. Mm-hmm. So probably seems maybe counterintuitive, but one of the things I would suggest is to create participation cultures where people can participate with a very low bar to entry, maybe just showing up and get to be a part of it. But then also asking people to refrain from making that space a spectacle for people who, you know, don't want to participate in it. So that's.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
I think I very much was moved by the whole thing, but especially the important poems about the child killer. So I was trying to guess how much of that was, I suspect, just glancing around, I might be the only other person in the room who remembers it or knew about it. How much of that was memories from that time? And I was working in an orphanage not far from where the first kid was working at the time. It just really moved me. I'm curious how much of that was memory from that. You must have been really young.
Thank you for that. I was very young at the time. I don't think I was aware when those things were happening, but the impact of those events shaped my whole school experience. I certainly my elementary school experience. So we did have the police officers come in every year and fingerprint us at first. We thought that was fingerprinting at school. And I think I was probably in fourth or fifth grade when I realized it would be to identify our bodies if we were abducted. And there was such a casualness about it, and you know, also a necessity about it because of that set of murders went unsolved. They just they think they know who did it. He passed away recently, but they're not sure if that was the person. So it was a specter that kind of hung over us. Definitely shaped my sense of, you know, safety, especially just the idea that riding your bike, you know, you could disappear.
Yeah, I mean, we tried to keep the news from, I was working with kids that age at the time. It was horrible trying to keep, you know, of course they learned about it at schools and we had to do it. But anyway, thank you for those and for everything.
Thank you so much for coming and reading this thing. I just wanted to ask, because we talk about narrative work across both genres and probably more, you know, I guess I'm just wondering, because it seems in your work, there's this earnest belief that like your lived experience is theory. And so when you talk about researching and kind of taking on your sort of like historian methodologies, how is it kind of validating your feelings, your experience with empirical data, and just kind of what was that process like as a creative process?
Thank you for that question. I think that's one of the hardest things I think about writing essays that have a historical component. Is that you get so much material and you have to figure out how to sort through that material and find a story or find an atmosphere or find an angle through it. And in some ways it's really messy because usually there's more that I want, a lot more that I want to include than I can actually use. I try to be very clear that I'm not a historian. So when I'm invoking history, I really want to have it illuminate my imagination. I need it to do that because that's, you know, what I'm doing. Sometimes I use secondary sources, other people's history. I do a lot of reporting on my own, even if it's just tracking through a geography. Even for Troy, Michigan, I did a lot of walks and, you know, tried to take pictures of things so that I knew where everything was in relation. One image that I couldn't pull up the screen that I had hoped to pull was this inset image from the book, which is the you see all these squiggly lines. So you have a city that's designed with a grid, and then you have the suburban lines, which are paper drawn around the grid, and it's a very artificial landscape. You know, not all suburbs are like that, but the one Troy is very much like that. And, you know, I would get those kinds of planning documents. One of the things that I would study here as an undergrad, I was an African American Studies and English major in CAS. I was really focused on urban planning and landscape design. So I think that I have always been open to multiple kinds of sources. And I'll say that that's probably what led me away from being a more traditional literature professor, that the source materials I wanted to work with were actual material pieces of evidence from the way that people live. You know, the tactile stuff has great energy for thinking creatively. So, yeah, so maybe a bad historian. Or spooky historian.
We can do one more question. Okay. I know you teach now to New York.
Yes, I teach at college.
And so I know people are always talking, they're teaching a deep pattern and your friends from author. Suddenly students are asking certain questions. Today you're being interviewed as you had recently. What are some of the most important things you've given to impress to them or that they leave your class with?
You know, I think I really try to impress upon the importance of rigorous reporting and research and what they do. Even if they're writing a memoir or even if they're writing through personal experience, that essay I read to you about the Black Boston Association Party, I interviewed Brian, his best friend Brian, his kid, she lives in Texas. She couldn't be like, what are you even calling me about? and I hadn't talked to her for years. Researched the, you know, obviously the institution, and I talked to the Black Law Students Association president here. Everything that I do is really about validating and making sure that accurately, because my memory is really soft and it makes things very pretty, but it doesn't create tension in the work. And at least for me as a nonfiction writer, it's really important to have the tension that comes from truth and from truthful work as a part of the work instead of some animating energy. So I really try to get my students to do that because a lot of them are working in the space of memory. Instead of vexed memory or difficult memories, which, you know, I want them to feel powerful in the work as they're writing about it. So they need to have the information. I think they're hungry to do, they don't know how to do it, but you know, as you all know, we teach you how to do it.
Oh, thank you for joining us.
Earlier today, we did have words, but we do appreciate your presence.
Thank you.
You wanted to say something. We've been able to hear that piece to the end. I admittedly lost track of time. I think we're reading, it's so beautiful. And thank you, Kira, for facilitating Q&A. Thank you, Lamar, for your introduction. And for posting on Zoom. As a reminder, Wendy will be giving a craft talk tomorrow morning from 10 to 11 a.m. titled Be Useful on Writing and Design. You can join us for that in person in Angel Hall 3222 or on Zoom using the same link that was sent out for tonight's event. If you'd like to receive notifications about our events in the future, you can sign up for our email list using the sign up sheet on the table that's right outside the auditorium door, or if you're on Zoom by following the link that's dropped in the chat. That's all I have. So many thanks again for coming out tonight and enjoy the rest of your evening.